All right. Good morning. I may have to let everything cool off for a while. I'm not sure that people are in any mood for the for listen to the truth at this point. That's possible. I mean, this is in the back of my mind. Say, you know, it is a possibility that everyone's so on edge right now they just can't assimilate the truth. And if I keep banging my head against the wall, I might get really frustrated. Whereas if I wait a little while, and people, the shock wears off. Say, "Oh my God, we're really in trouble. We got to listen to the truth." Then maybe they will. So I got to probably take that into account. Maybe I'll have a vacation or something. It would be Longchenpa would have to arrange that. And you know, I'd have to accept that. I understand the wisdom of that. This is what I'm seeing as a definite, you know, as a possibility. Because I'm seeing so clearly now everything. And to speak this to those who are defensive about it's too difficult. They'll get an ulcer. They can't stomach it. They can't stomach it. But when things get desperate enough, they may repent, you see. They may say, "Oh gosh, okay. Interesting, huh? Yeah." So it may be that there are times when you have to back off. Now you know, I'm willing to do that. I'm willing to not back off either way. But what I have to say, again, may be it's unpalatable to the unrepentant. It is unpalatable, and it has to be said. So you just have to wait until you know, those have repented and said, "Wow, this just isn't working for me." You know, you have to really repent, and we have a very difficult time with repentance. We don't want to do that because of continuity. Fear tells us, "Oh, I'll have so much." Yeah, well. So I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what to say, because if I say what I want to say, it may be too strong for people. They just say, I don't feel that I need that sort of intensity yet. I think maybe we can work with it. Maybe, you know, and so they stop short of actually listening. There's a difference between saying, "I'll listen to this tomorrow," and actually listening to what's being said now. And most listen with this ear saying, "Do I want to listen to this tomorrow or not?" They don't really listen. Okay, right? They're evaluating, is this something I want to pay attention to tomorrow? You see that? They're not paying attention to it now. They're paying attention to the question of, do I want to pay attention to this later? And this is what happens here. I know I kid, you know, the gurus, and I don't know if they've complained about it really, but they've certainly mentioned it. I hope they're not surprised. They must not be. But they say, "Well, we come into the world to help, and people end up idolizing and worshiping us, and they, you know, and we don't really help, and you know, bitter idols are made, and you know, wow." I said, "Well, what do you expect? This is a place here, which is where those who want to change reality, this is where they hang out. So of course, if you come into this world and you have all this correct, you know, spiritual charisma, and they're going to say, 'Oh, here's the one that's going to help change the facts of reality for us,' and we've just worshipped them enough that they'll do it for us." Of course, that's what everyone's going to do. You'd be lucky if you find a single person here that won't do that. So they may have to take a different tactic in the future here. It hasn't worked out well, to say the least. You get a great guru, and then the devotees just think, "Oh, the gurus, yeah, finally, someone's going to change the facts of reality for me, and then I'll be happy. Because I just don't feel I fit into reality so well." Meaning, the desire to change the facts of reality doesn't fit into reality so well. That's right, it doesn't. That means you need to give up the effort to change the facts. Can't change the facts. But we're trying to. And so we have a continuity fear, and we don't realize that. As soon as we recognize a continuity fear is a problem, then we see the gurus in the right light. They're our friends. They are true. They are what we really are. And they're here to tell us we can't change the facts of reality. They're not here to change the facts of reality. They're not here for us to worship them and empower them so they can change the facts of reality or make them say, please, 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 you know, just do it for me, please, please, please. That'll never work. That'll never work. So we have these, so the cults are made, religious cults are made around these guru figures from those who pleading with them to change the facts of reality, and that's impossible. None of the gurus said the facts of reality can be changed, or that they're here to change the facts of reality. They didn't say that at all. But you come into a world where that's what everybody wants. Of course they're going to look at you that way. And if you say, I can't change the facts, then they don't want anything to do with you. Say, what a pity. You could have been so helpful to me, you know. And it's overwhelmingly that way here. Ananda Mahima said, gee, you know, throughout my whole life, millions and millions have come to me, but very few indeed have come to me for the truth. In other words, almost everyone came to her pleading with her to change the facts of reality. Almost everyone. She said, some did come for the genuine love of truth. Some did, but it's very, very small amount. Very small amount. But should we be surprised about that? No, not at all. What do you expect? I don't know. Do the gurus come in here not understanding this? They must. That's the first thing you have to understand coming here, is that everybody's going to hope that you're the one that God sent to change the facts of reality. You know, they say, Jesus, God sent Jesus to change the facts of reality. That's what they believe. No, just the opposite. God sent Jesus to say, you can't change the facts of reality. In other words, you cannot disempower yourself. It's impossible. Cannot disempower yourself. Now, we're terrified of this message, okay? So the first step of repentance, one of the main steps of repentance is to say, I'm terrified of my power, right? I have a severe continuity problem. I don't want to be empowered. I want to find some way to be disempowered because I've forgotten how to use my power. I think I'll mess up so bad, you know. We're honest with ourselves, and we say, I have a very severe continuity fear around this. So thank you, Jesus, you're not wrong. Thank you, gurus, you're right. But I have a very severe continuity problem about this, so can you please be patient with me? So there are different phases that we go through as we become disillusioned that the guru is not here to change reality for us. It's like, we can become very atheistic, right, at that point. Hate God. You know, people say, you know, the ones that hope that Jesus would change reality for them now are the ones that are hating God and hating Jesus. Yeah. Did you know that? They're very, very angry and upset. God doesn't exist. You know, we thought that God sent his only son here to change the facts of reality for us, so we'd be comfortable, so we would be right and feel comfortable with our arrogance. And he didn't do that. So there must be no God, and Jesus is a fraud and all this. You know, and they go through this very belligerent phase. And we're very much into that in the world right now. So you really can't talk to these people. It's a phase, and how do you bring them out of that phase? Well, A Course in Miracles was an attempt to bring them out of that phase. And some have been helped by that. Some are being helped. And then, so there's that phase where you go through that reconnecting, saying, wow, okay, so it was my mistake. And then then you become more clear with the continuity fear, and then you can go back to the gurus and see them as our friends, and see them really as just ourself, ourself helping us out, helping us get free of continuity fear. And you have a different relationship with them. You're not a slavish devotee worshiping them, hoping they can change reality for you. And you become centered in your spiritual practice of evaporating continuity fear. And that's where you work at. That's what you work at that then. You become very diligent working on that. So these are these phases. So right now in the world, there's this very rebellious phase that's been exploited by the extraterrestrials, actually. And it's a very dangerous phase where getting God to change the facts of reality didn't work. So they're very bitter and rebellious now. And here come the ETs saying, we can change facts of reality. Look at all this. We can manipulate electromagnetism. And we become suckers for this. Of course, electromagnetism is nothing but pretend. So it's like, I can change my pretending around this way or that way. It's, you know, so what? It's still the belief in disempowerment, isn't it? Electromagnetism is a belief in disempowerment, that we can disempower ourselves. So this electromagnetic universe is the belief that we can disempower ourselves, that spirit can disempower themselves. So, and we want it, we believe that manipulating electromagnetism is changing reality. It's not. It's like, that's like manipulating a dream makes the dream real. No, it doesn't. So we're in this rebellious phase, and the world has gotten into an alliance with extraterrestrials who are really just really into manipulating electromagnetism. That's what they do. A lot of them. And so the world's not interested in listening to the fact you can't change the facts of reality. See, they think the universe is reality. No, it isn't. Meaning, the belief in time, space, process, and form is just belief. It's not fact. It's a belief that we can change reality, and we can't change reality. So it's just a absurd belief, you might say. It's an absurd belief. There's nothing there to it, nothing to it. So you have these different phases, and so right now there's this very nasty phase in the world, and I'm not sure, you know, what to do about it. I'm you know, opening my eyes to it and saying, you know, my God, it's horrible. So what is the right thing to do? This is the question. We'll just give this to the gurus and say, we would like your guidance on this, gurus, for sure. So we always listen in the wow mode. We're going to be shocked by what is said. I test out what I say a little bit ahead of time, at least in my own clarity. Some of it just arises spontaneously. A lot of it, but a lot of this I've covered a little bit enough to feel that it's safe. It's not a problem. And then occasionally, you know, breakthroughs come that I haven't never thought of before, right? Well, a lot of times they do. So it's a kind of a mixture of the two. I don't rehearse any of the taping, but what I say is, I may have in my contemplations and practice, I may have gone over this in some way, so I feel comfortable enough to speak about it and feel it's not going to cause a problem. It hasn't caused a problem. It causes a wow. I say, wow, that's great. So we don't. If we may know what we need to do. We're just trying to accept it. I mean, we may need to back off for a little while. I may need to back off. It's possible. I'm getting very adamant now, and people may not be in the mood for that because they're just, you know, they're hoping they can get God, so you know, and the ultimate device that we use is the goddess. Okay, that's the ultimate deception that we use for ourselves. And I broke up with the goddess, so that's why I'm able to speak this way. She just said, you know, I don't think we're compatible. I said, yeah, you know what? I don't think we're compatible either. We're not. And of course, the goddess is just a wishful thinking, a projection of our own wishful thinking, that there's some power that can change the facts of reality. And she tells us that she can do it. Of course, because that's, we put words in our mouth. She never speaks any of her own words. We put words in her mouth. It's just a puppet device we use. We think, oh, the goddess just told us she knows how to change reality. Great, let's keep trusting in it then. You know, she can do it. Now, no one can do it. Okay, it's impossible. It's not difficult, it's impossible. So it's not difficult, it's impossible. It's not difficult, it's impossible. So I think everyone needs to cool off for a while at this point. So I'm game for that. I how it would happen would be a miracle for me. I keep, you know, spending every penny that I have and pennies that I don't have actually at all. I have to get help. To get some gear, get some more tripods. I just ordered some, and to try and be able to produce, you know, videos that help cool you down. Help. It's okay, you know, that you can't change the facts of reality, because God understands that you're afraid of your power, because you've been trying to disempower yourself, that you have very severe continuity fear. So, you know, it's the most helpful, liberating thing of all is to admit you have a very severe continuity fear problem. I mean, it's the greatest thing ever. And so just try it. Just try it. And instead of being depressed, it'll be just the opposite. You say, thank God, I finally understand what my trouble is. And I see that I'm not going to be just catapulted into full power. When we say go fast and fast your practice, yeah, go fast in your practice of recognizing your continuity fear and getting used to working on it. That's what I mean, go fast. It doesn't mean get rid of all your continuity fear. You're not going to do that in the foreseeable future, okay? It's a very severe problem. So, there's no worries. I mean, you're not going to catapult yourself into full power. First, you're going to go through some very sublime, beautiful experiencing before you do full power, okay? Even the spirit of abidance is not full power, okay? So we don't even need to speak of full power. Nobody should be speaking of that. If they do, I would say don't pay attention to them. All right? We're not after the ultimate here at all. Not at all. And it's a joke to suggest that we are. Absolute joke. You know, total liberation, all this kind of stuff. It's a joke talking like that, actually. Now, sometimes that's showcased here. King of all ascetics like Ram Maharshi gave us a taste, and reminding us, okay. But pragmatically, it's a joke to think that we're going to do that. We're not. We're not going to do that. So don't even think about the ultimate. That's not your task. Your task is to just become very diligent in evaporating your continuity fear. That's it. That's it. That's all that's asked of you. Be very skillful in managing your success, very diligent in evaporating your continuity fear. That's all that's required. because it's you have to. It's a very severe problem, and you have to understand why you tend to go slow, why you have troubles. You have to forgive yourself and realize I have a very severe problem. I'm terrified of full power. I've been trying to disempower myself for so long. I've taken so many mental efforts. I've made so many mental efforts to disempower myself that I'm terrified of full power. I don't even know what that would be. I have no idea what that would be like. So of course we're not going to do that. It's ridiculous to assume that we would do that. The ego keeps trying to either or us in that way of like, well, either you have no power or full power. No, you can be diligent in evaporating your continuity fear. Okay, that's the other option that the ego never really, well, the ego, the dance of continuity fear, doesn't tell you that. You have to see it, and then you get it dancing the way you want it to dance. It's still there, but now you're doing the leading instead of it doing the leading of the dance. So the trouble in the world is that continuity fear is the one who's doing the leading of the dance, and we're just following the lead of the continuity fear and dancing. When you recognize, when you repent, you're the one who's now doing the leading and the dancing. The continuity fear is doing the following. That's how it is. And the problem in the world right now is we're trying to empower continuity fear so that it always does the leading. And the idea that we would do the lead in the dance of continuity fear is made illegal, made an anathema, made labeled as insanity. And this is what's coming in the world. This is what the world is trying to empower through politics, and religion, and social engineering, and education, entertainment, news, everything in this world is we're trying to empower continuity fear doing the lead. So we think, oh, that's just our role, that's just our role. Know your role, right? So we're trying to elect those who we think know what our role is, who will make sure that they, do everything legally to bind us to that role. And we're going to get the Clintons, okay? So the Clintons are experts at that. That's why we're empowering them, is to define what our role is and then legally bind us to that role in as many ways as possible. This is what's going to happen. And so this is a disaster, of course. Of course. And how to get past this disaster is the big question, isn't it? And there's nothing in my life that's set up in that direction except my own willingness. They say, well, there's a will, there's a way. Okay, so yeah, I have to believe that where there's a will, there's a way. I've got decent fitness. I've got my golf swing on. I could handle a vacation. A vacation's a difficult thing to handle, actually. You really have to work at it. Seriously. It's quite difficult because it's a complete change of what you're used to. It's funny, you talk to these strong guys and they say that they've never felt worse than after a round of golf. They go out to the driving range first, they hit 100 balls, and they play a round of golf. 2 days later, they say that they feel like they've been run over by a bus. It's true. It's very true. So you have to actually be very, very fit to not just feel wiped out after a round of golf. It tires it tires you out in ways that you don't expect at all. You say, "What is wrong with me?" Your back is killing you. Your ankles hurt. Your feet are aching. Your neck is sore. Your body just feels like a wreck. So how to play around a golf so you feel fine and relaxed afterwards, you know, that's like a great secret. That's how the pros know how to do that somehow. That they're very relaxed. You know, it's just, there's an art to it somehow. So it's been indicated that a vacation's coming up for me in some way. It's time to take a break from it all. And maybe just do some very beautiful videos to just help everybody chill out. Because people may not be in the mood to really dig into anything right now because they're so overburdened by what's going on in the world. They don't want anything more added to that. But at some point, you have to give up on the world, okay? What is the world except the hope that the facts of reality can be changed? That's all it is. At some point, you got to give up on that. But by recognizing you have a severe problem, this enables you to give up on the world. because you realize you won't be catapulted into full power. Because you're the one, this dance of cognitive fear is coming from you. The world actually is coming from us. So as long as we desire a dance to keep going on, it will. A dance of uncertainty, a dance that feels like, you know, I don't have full power. Okay. Then we will continue to do that. So it's a great relief to discover you have a problem. Continuity fear problem. A great relief. The greatest relief of all. I mean, it's just tremendous. So, we would have hoped in the, how many years has it been? A couple decades since the Clintons have been there or something, that we would have learned something. We would have advanced in wisdom enough, but apparently not. Right. It was like, wow, let's never see these we hope we never see these reprobates again. I mean, good riddance. I mean, you talk about moral decay, you talk about decay in every possible avenue, that's what they bring. And yet it's like a nightmare, they're back. You know, it's unbelievable. How is this possible? Well, it's a nightmare. We didn't learn our lesson after 8 years of it? Are you kidding me? But no, we just basically now world is so messed up. They're saying, yeah, I guess we got to submit to our fate. And it's continuity fear has to, you know, let's just let it lead the way. You know, in other words, don't repent. When you repent, now you're leading the dance, not continuity fear. And you're in charge of continuity fear. Okay, it's our child, you know, continuity fear. So if we decide we're going to do the leading, then that's what happens. It's a puppet. If you want to think the puppet's in charge of you, you know, good luck with that. Everyone, you know, secretly is hoping that they can find someone to change reality for them. So that special relationship is that. The special relationship is based on the hope that you can find someone to change reality for you. Now, I know this is a little different than A Course in Miracles. They say it's all based on guilt and this stuff. I don't, you know, that is one way of looking at it. I prefer to look at it this way. Just as I prefer to say our problem is continuity fear rather than the ego. You know, so it is, it's talking about the exact same thing. There's stylistic differences. And I just like this style better, that's all. And I don't hold Jesus to that style. That was a style that came up because of the mindset of those who he was working to reach. It's not his style necessarily, okay? He doesn't really have any particular style. It's whatever is suggested by the grace of God in terms of reaching, you know, this, okay, this will be helpful right here, right now, but later on it's something else. So the Bible was a certain style, you know, a certain style, and the Course of Miracles was a different style. Jesus, okay, I don't crucify him on the cross of style, okay? Don't crucify anyone on the cross of style. Maybe at some point I'll have a different style. I change every day in certain ways. I'm even wearing a different style here of clothing today. I haven't tried this one. So don't crucify anyone to a style. But right now, I'm comfortable with this style. I like the continuity fear is absolutely the key. We don't need to use the term ego so much. It's a dance of continuity fear. That's way more empowering to look at it that way. But for those who are terrified of empowerment, it's better for them to see it as the ego. You know, the ego, or before there was the devil. You know, they're really, really scared of empowerment. It's the devil. And then a little less scared, now it's the ego. And then when you get even less scared of empowerment, then it's the dance of continuity fear. Okay? It's like that. There's a progression. And you know, a lot of fear of empowerment. So Jesus is God, you know, and then less fear of empowerment. Jesus is this great spiritual master, like awesome, you know, spiritual. And then later on, it says, "Oh, Jesus is my friend. He's my friend." And then ultimately, so Jesus is myself. I am that. So you go. There are these phases that we go through, and you have to go through them. Pretty much so. I mean, you can certainly shorten the phases, that's for sure. So Jesus says the special relationship, I mean, the relationships we have in the world, he you know, he says that's the major impediment to us. Well, continuity fear is the major impediment, and that's one way that it dances, that we, but it's the most prevalent way, you might say. In terms of most, try that over and over and over. And we're really hoping that we can find someone who can change the facts of reality for us. If we just, quote unquote, love them enough. As I say, I'll give you love, you change the facts of reality for me. I'm here for you, I'll give you all the love you need, but your job is to change the facts of reality for me. Sound familiar? Yeah. I know the women will say, "Yeah, that's what the men try to do." And the men will say, "Yeah, that's what the women try to do." Okay, so the special relationship is—that's exactly what's going on when you're hoping that someone can change the facts of reality for you. And then when they don't, you get very disappointed, very angry, and upset, and feel betrayed. And then you go worship the mother, the ultimate, the last refuge for the damned, you know. They go, say, "No, I, mother will change the fact. I just got to worship her and she'll change the facts of reality." A lot of people worship an eye to my mother as the mother, hoping that she can change the facts of reality for them. Of course she can't do that. Cannot. She told them, "Don't worship me as mother." She made very clear. But, I mean, did she really expect them not to? Of course they would. They just said, "Yes, mother." You know, she said, "Don't worship me as mother. I'm your sister. I'm your daughter. I'm a little child, but not the mother." And they'd say, "Yes, Ma, yes, Mother, yes, Mother, whatever you say, Mother." In other words, "Okay, we'll do whatever you say, as long as, you, and then you will change the facts of reality for us, right? Okay, great." You know, you got to either laugh or get very bitter about it. So what I see the way to go is simply, we have to repent, recognize we have a continuity fear, and this solves all of that. It absolutely does, because we know that our continuity fear, we're generating, and so we won't allow ourselves to be catapulted into full power. We are able to keep perception. Right? We're able to keep perception for a while. We can change how we're perceiving, absolutely we can. And that's what will happen. But we'll keep perception around. We'll keep belief around, perception around. So we're not trying to get rid of that. No. We're trying to evaporate as much of it as possible. But as you evaporate it, then you become less frightful, and you get used to the wow, and you get, you know, manage your success, full stop in the wow. And then you evaporate some more, and you get used to that. You evaporate some more, and you get used to that. And so it does. So it's smooth. It doesn't feel like you're being catapulted into anything. You just say, "Oh yeah, I'm comfortable with this." So you're moving your comfort zone. This is the way that it has to go. And the world is just they keep doing the same old thing, expecting a different result, pounding their head against the wall, expecting a different result, and then being super bitter and angry and upset and blaming others, screaming about victimization and everything. And it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And you know, it's so easy. Just repent. Recognize you have a severe problem. You can't believe what a relief that is for you. You keep thinking it's other people have the problem. You don't. It's they have the problem. That's horrible. Because you're not in control then of the problem. They are. You see? When you realize, no, I have a problem. It's my problem, not yours. I got the problem. Own the problem. That's the greatest thing there is, as far from our standpoint at this point. Other than the realization of reality, the full realization, that's the greatest thing of all, is to own that you have a problem. It's a continuity of your problem. It's not your problem at all. It's my problem. You see? It's my problem. You don't own my problem. You can't manipulate my problem. It's my problem. I can manipulate it. I can decide how much of my problem I want to have. Do you get this? It's super empowering. So this whole victim consciousness, you're the reason about, that's the worst thing. It's hell. That's mental illness. You will feel, as soon as you repent, you will feel this feeling. You know, what is this feeling? That's the feeling of mental health. Now, it's not perfect mental health, because perfect mental health, there's not even a question of mental health. But we're not going towards that ultimacy at this point. We're not going to flounder in this ultimacy-ness. No, we just keep working on evaporating our continuity fear, and guess what? We'll smoothly get there at some point. We'll smoothly get there. It'll be easy. Piece of cake. So we're not floundering here. You know what I'm saying? Non-dual, yeah, ultimacy. How come I can't get the ult? We don't do that here. We look at it and we thank you for bringing it to our attention, but we are smoothly evaporating our continuity fear and wowing the success of this. That's why I drink smoothies. That's my main food, smoothies, because we're doing it very smooth here. All right, we're not trying to eat the steak. We're drinking blended blueberries and strawberries and apple juice and stuff. I love a little pizza. I had a little, some cold pizza this morning, a little bit. So those who haven't repented end up being, you know, goddess worshippers, mother worshippers, saying, no, they say, that's the last refuge. It says, I have the most faith that my mother can change reality, right? Because when we're children, the mother seems to be able to do all these amazing things, right? We cry, there's the food. I'm in pain, there's the, you know, she's there. She seems like, you know, a goddess to us, right? That she seems to be able to manipulate. She's all-powerful to a little infant. The mother seems all-powerful. So, the mother worship is the court of last refuge, the harbor of last refuge. What do you call it? The last resort of the damned. You know, the last resort of the insane, of pleading with mother to, you know, change reality. It says, mother, no one else can do it, but we have faith you can do it. This is an infantile reaction. Okay, it's an infantile reaction. It's trying to infantize yourself. And then hoping that if I just infantize myself, mother will then I'll be able to experience again that mother can change anything. You know, oh, too much light. Okay, she shuts the blinds. You know, we don't know. We think that she actually caused the sun to stop shining. Okay, we don't understand blinds. The mother lowers the blinds, and as a little child, oh, the bright sun's hitting me in the face. It's blinding me. It's so bad. Ma, I'm crying. She goes, oh, okay, the sun. Then she closes the blinds, and suddenly the infant is cool now. There's no more sun hitting, and the infant says, oh, there's some all-powerful figure that is able to stop the light from shining. You know, oh, great. So this is our experience of mother, our infantile experience, is we think that she's omnipotent. Whereas the fact is all she did was you know, turn the blinds and the, you know, to block the sun. She didn't stop the sun from shining. So when we're not unrepentant, we become mother worshipers. This is what happens. That's why we're electing Hillary Clinton president. Because we become mother worshippers. And we expect then to be infantized. And this is why most people in the society are like infants. Jesus said, don't become like infantized. Become like a little child. You know, like a five-year-old or something. You know, they're wonderful, right? Because they realize their mother's not omnipotent. It's a shade, you know. But they're free-flowing and not planning for tomorrow. They're in the now, in the moment. You know, it's just a metaphor. It's kind of a metaphor. But we're not supposed to be infantized where we think mother can change reality. That's the worst. That's the worst place to be. And this is, I go out, I'm walking among people. They all have dogs, you know. And it's so obvious to me that they're like infants. And they're just hoping that mother will change reality for them. So they, you know, that their problems will be solved. That they're, you know, they're terrified of their power. I said, mother, please take my power away. You know, please block the light from shining. It's scaring me. It's hurting me. And this, so we have an infantile society right now, very much so, severely so. I'm walking through Home Depot yesterday, and it's just like, I mean, I can't take it, you know, anymore. It's just horrible. The people are so infantile. Their mindset is so infantile. Everyone. Actually, I was going into this electronics store, and there's these steps, real steep steps leading up to the store. And this guy comes walking past me, and I'm starting to go up the steps, and I hear bump, 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 bump. I look up, he's up top. I said, oh my God, what did he do? He ran doubles the whole way up, bump, 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 bump. And so I go into the store and I'm walking along the aisle, and he's ahead of me. And then he gets diverted and he goes back behind me. He needs to do something. And then he catches up and he's starting to walk past me again. And I just sort of turn to him and I say, hey, I really love the way you crushed those steps, man. That was awesome. And then he looks at me, he laughs and he says, hey, I got to get my exercise somehow, right? And I say, yeah, man, it's great. Great cardio, you know, it's awesome. And he was not infantile. It was a guy, and he understood. A stranger could call out to him like that and say something, and he's right in the flow, and he liked it, you know. It didn't faze him the slightest bit, and he understood that I had seen him run up the stairs, and I said, hey, I saw you, and I love it. I followed suit, because after I saw that, I ran the stairs, you see. So that's not an infant, you know. That's not an infantile attitude that he had. He said, you know, hey, I got to practice, man. I commended him. I said, there's some stairs. Why not run up the stairs? That's what he said. Hey, I got to get my exercise within the midst of a busy day. So there's somebody who gets it, okay? He gets it. That in the midst of our life, we have to practice. We have to get our spiritual practice in, our continuity fear practice in, are wowing the day. We have to do that in the midst of our life. That's what Ramana said. In the midst of the turmoils of your life, you must get your practice in. Your determination to evaporate continuity fear. We must do that. I hope this microphone, it's a bad wire on the headset. And so I taped it and I tried to keep it from moving. And hopefully it's working. Thank you for pointing that out, Craig. I'm ordering a new headset. It should be here in about a week, and hopefully that will take care of it. I bought one yesterday, and I said, I don't know if this is going to work, because it looks like it only has one jack. I need two, because this computer has a headphone and microphone, separate jacks. And of course, the tech guy there, as they always do, they say, oh, no problem. No, this will work fine. I said, are you sure? He says, yeah. The single jack is made to work with just one jack. Now, that'll work for your computer, yeah, I'm sure. And I was thinking, like, you know what? How many hundreds of times have tech people assured me that everything's perfectly fine? It turned out to be, you know, just liars. You know, they always say that. It's extraordinary. Our society is just a lying society that says, oh, yeah, technology will solve everything. Don't worry. It's everything's fine. So I get home. I plug in the single jack. Of course, it doesn't work. And then later on, I'd have to dig into it. And the internet, to me, the internet is interesting for what it has, but it's even more interesting for what it doesn't have. And a lot of the information I want, it doesn't have. I mean, most of the searches I do, there's no information. This indicates that the tech people, are very blind to their shortcomings. It's like, no, there's no problem. What we're doing is infallible. You know? Now, we can change reality, no problem. That's their attitude. The tech people have believed they can change reality. That's why we're worshiping them. We're enthralled by them. Technology and the mother. Those two things, we're enthralled by it. A very infantile attitude based on continuity fears leading us, doing the dance, dancing us into infantilism. And then claiming that empowerment, no, that's infantile. Oh, you know, they got it completely backwards. They say, no, Ramana's infantile. You're sitting there like a baby not doing it. They got it completely backwards. Now, remember, Rama said, I'm not the body, I'm the teaching. His teaching wasn't infantile at all, was it? He said, the body doesn't need to do anything because the teaching's doing everything. Everything is done, is already done. So what do I need to do to the body? Nothing. I just sit quietly, don't do anything with the body. It's the teaching. It's the presence. So the world right now is getting into us. Maybe we all have to take a break for a while so maybe we'll take like an 8-year break or something. I don't know how long. Play golf for 8 years. Rome's burning. Get out of Rome, kind of thing. They want to burn Rome to the ground. Okay, let's spread out. Let's go somewhere else. Oh, but there's nowhere better than Rome. Really? Maybe there is. I'm going to be surprised to find it, won't it? Yeah. But it's infantile to say there's no place, no other place, right? Very infantile. And good luck, you know, with infantile mother worshippers. I mean, good luck trying to change that around. I mean, that's a phase. And until they repent, you can't do anything. Their minds are so closed, you can't do anything. They'll just try to suck you in to glamorizing their worship of the mother so that she stays all powerful in their eyes, and they stay infantile, and they keep believing that she can change reality. Because deep down, they there's some doubts. So they say, no, if I just make her seem even greater in my eyes, then that'll remove the doubts. Now, the doubts are never removed because we know it's a lie. Our spirit is still within us, right? Everything is still the same. We're just dreaming. It's like we're afraid to wake up and say, what can I do to keep dreaming? So how do I manipulate the dream to keep the dreamer dreaming the dream? You know, that's what the dreamer's doing. How do I make this dream interesting so I don't wake up from it? But it's scary to those who have gone to an infantile regression, worshiping the mother. It's very scary for them to hear any truth at all. They just want you to worship the mother, and if you have capabilities, they want you to help glamorize the worship of the mother for them so that they feel, you know, that this is the right thing to do and I can keep doing it, and they think you're helping them. So they'll say, oh, thank you so much for helping me worship the mother. I was starting to feel like maybe there's something better way than that. I starting to repent, but now if you can help me worship the mother, that'd be great. That, you know, you're so helpful. Let me give you a hug. Isn't that wonderful? So they seduce you in this way, in this world, because they're willing to applaud you and thank you and say, oh, it's so wonderful. You helped me focus on worshiping the mother and keep believing that she can change reality for me. That's taking away my anxiety. It's wonderful. And so they're willing to lionize you and say how wonderful you are if you do that for them. But of course, you're just, you know, drugging them with delusion. Mother worship's like a drug of delusion. And again, the people want to say, well, not to my mom's mother. No, she wasn't. First of all, she didn't have any children, okay, at all. She never played the role of the mother, actually. It was the divine child, the role that she played. And everybody keep trying to tell her, you're the mother, you're the mother, you're the mother. What could she do? She said, what can I do? You all insist I'm the mother. And, I'm not, you'll get very angry with me if I don't at least allow you to call me mother, which she tried to tell them not to, but they insisted on it. So she, what can I do? She said, I'm really the divine child. Okay, that's what I really am. There's no mother here at all. I'm just your friend. I'm the divine child. I'm your friend. I am what you really are. That's what I am. So how could, the whole idea of the mother is that you're not the mother. You can never be the mother. Mother's all powerful. You're just a little infant. As Ananda Maima said, when you see me as the mother, you're disempowering yourself. You're creating a distancing thing. And that's how you're trying to disempower yourself. So please don't do that. They didn't listen to her. And she knew they wouldn't. But so still, though, she did what she did was still helpful for us, to those who want to repent. I never saw her as the mother, but the world insists upon it. The devotees insist upon it. I tried helping them say, hey, look, she's our divine sister, but they say, oh, yeah, ma, yeah, and they go right back to the mother thing. It's just they're addicted to that. The very thing she said don't do, they're addicted to it. And the same thing with Jesus. Jesus, don't call me good, don't call me good. The very thing that Jesus told us not to do, we did. Don't crucify while we crucify Jesus, you see. Crucified him to our desire to worship him. Crucified him in our desire to see him as capable of changing reality, changing the facts of reality. And of course, we think that death is reality. No, death is just a temper tantrum of our desire to believe that we can change the facts of reality. It's just more of our imagination is all it is. So it may be that people are desperate to worship someone, so maybe I need to take a vacation from the world at this time. So that doesn't happen to me. I don't have any desire for that. It's a very tricky thing because almost virtually everyone that comes to you wants coming to you hoping that you can change reality for them. That you're the Messiah. See, the Jews wanted a Messiah, change the facts of reality. Jesus said, no, you can't change the facts of reality. And so they said, well, you're no Messiah then. We don't want you. Let's crucify you. You're setting a bad example. You're tempting us away from our Messiah, right? It was the Jews that brought the charges against Jesus. They just used Roman law to crucify him. They claimed he was causing sedition against the Romans and stuff, which was a crime punishable by death. But they're the ones who brought up all the charges. It wasn't the Romans. The Romans didn't want anything to do with it. Was it Herod washed his hands? I don't know. Or was it, go see, who was it, Pontius Pilate? Pilate said, I don't find anything wrong with this guy at all. Stop bothering me with this stuff. No, this is the guy that's causing sedition. He's saying we shouldn't pay taxes, blah, blah. So they try all these trumped up charges against Jesus. So the Sanhedrin couldn't execute Jesus under Roman law. Capital punishment was only possible under Roman law because Judea was under Roman governance at that time. It was a province being governed by the Romans. And so they brought charges, you know, these trumped up charges, so that capital punishment would be applied to Jesus and they got get rid of him. Because they thought all their sacrifices to God, you know, would bring them a Messiah who would teach them how to, you know, change the facts of reality, or would do it for them. All this worshiping of death, saying, "Look, God, we believe that life can die, so, you know, we're worshiping a God of death." They were worshiping an imaginary, a God of their own imagination, hoping that in doing so, by sacrificing this God, it would change facts of reality. It would empower their imagination to change the facts of reality. And they hope that the sacrifice of Jesus was the final step required in their whole sacrificial belief system to that they actually did change the facts of reality. This is what they believe. So a lot of some of Christianity, at least one, the egoic aspect of it, the continuity fear aspect of it, is to believe that reality has been changed, that the death of Jesus changed reality. It didn't do anything. Jesus resurrected and said, "Look, didn't do anything. See, I'm back." It was just a belief. Death is just your imagination. But reality is not subject to your imagination. I played along with your imagination, say, "Okay, I'll imagine along with that." But I'm just showing you it's all your imagination, nothing more than that. So we've been struggling with that, you know, ever since. The Old Testament folks dismiss this, say, no. Blood of Christ changed reality. And the New Testament folks are, you know, struggling with it as we're going through different phases throughout history, which we've done. It's continued to go through different phases. It's all how much continuity fear do you have? That's the phase that you're in. And the more you evaporate, you go into a different phase. It's just like that. So don't crucify yourself just because you're in some phase. If you're a mother worshiper, don't crucify yourself. You just realize, you know, you've got continuity fear to evaporate. It's indication that there's more continuity fear you need to evaporate, for sure. There's a lot there. So be happy. I got a lot of continuity fear. Okay, great. But as soon as you accept that it's your problem, you stop, realize, you realize, "Oh, I don't need to do all this worshiping and stuff. That's nonsense." Appeasement worship, you know, propitiatory worship and help change reality. When I mean devotion to the gurus, I'm not asking them to change reality for me. I'm saying, no, make it clear to me reality can't be changed. And that becomes miraculous because all this stuff, the world, is our belief reality can be changed. And the miracle is we start seeing, no, it can't. So all this stuff doesn't change it. So Jesus resurrected the dead. He's saying, "Look, I'm just showing you that you can't change life. You can't kill life." Oh, how wonderful. So the light appearing to us, realize, oh, we can't kill the light. We can't kill the mind. Oh, how wonderful. We can't change the light. We can imagine it changed, but it's just our imagination. It doesn't really change it at all. So we can't truly disempower ourselves. So we have the power to go somewhere else. We have the power to experience in a different way. We're not crucified here. Wow, right? So that is not. See, if we take the universe of this dream of time, space, process form to be reality, then we think miracles are changing reality. It's the opposite. Miracles are just showing us that we can't change reality, meaning we still have full power. But it's revealed to us bit by bit. We only accept a little bit. See, you mean I have the power to take a vacation from this world? Yeah. Or you mean I have the power to back away from the madness? Yeah. So we call it a miracle, but it's not a miracle. You know, Jesus walking on the water, he's just saying, "Look, this world has no power over the Son of God at all. And you are the Son of God. It has no power over you. If you want to walk on the water, you can walk on it. If you want to have the storm calm down, the storm will calm down. So nothing has power over you. But this world is a belief, is the belief that something has power over us. We being reality itself, we believe that something has power over us. In other words, can change what we are. This is just an expression of our desire to change reality. Disempower ourselves. And it's just an absurd whim we had, that's all. I wonder if we can change, I wonder if we can disempower ourselves. I wonder if we can change reality. So we have an absurdist dream, an absurdist fantasy, idle, wishful thinking, and that's all that it is. But we, you know, again, but we still have severe continuity fear, so relax. It'll still be, the world's still going to be here for you. We may be able to see it in a different way, or we may be able to go to some other world. But this world will still be here, and the other world will still be there, and, you know, like that. Perception will still have perception. So cherish your continuity for fear, and but it's your problem, okay? So you control how much fear you have, how much continuity fear you have. Don't try to get rid of fear. Don't try to kill fear. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Totally absurd to say that. Kill fear. That's the last thing you want to do. That's what causes fear. If you want to keep fear, just keep trying to kill fear. If you want to keep the ego, just keep trying to kill the ego. That's how you'll keep it. Instead, embrace it and say, oh, thank you, continuity fear, because you're just expression. I'm you're my problem. I'm producing you. And I thank you for being here because that means reality's still, I'm still all-powerful, really, because you can't leave me. My effects cannot leave the cause at all. Effects can't leave the cause. And continuity fear is an effect of my desire that it be there. And then thank you for being there and say, okay, I'm going to work and I'm going to lessen the amount, the intensity of it. Okay, and then guess what? You'll feel, yeah. Continuity fear will say, yeah, that's okay. I'll go along with that. And then you can lessen it. That's how you do it. So don't be a fool. Don't try to crucify the fear. That just keeps it severe. That's how you keep severe fear. Trying to kill the ego is how you keep severe egoic complex. Trying to crucify fear is how you stay very fearful. The fear is your friend, actually. Look at it as a friend. And you see it that way, it's my problem. Then you'll allow yourself to lessen the intensity of it. You'll allow that. I allow myself that. I give myself, okay. I allow myself, okay, we're going to lessen the fear a little bit here. We're going to evaporate some of it. Not too much, but some of it. And you know what? And then the fear aligns with that purpose. Says, yeah, it's okay. Great. We trust you. That's why I said I had that dream where I was freed from this psychotic world. Because the world trusted me. Meaning I trusted myself to be free of it, of the world. That's really what it meant. Since this world's my own projection, it's your projection too, right? So I trusted myself, saying I'm not going to forget the world or denigrate, try to destroy it, you know, or any of that stuff. I said, no, you can stay there. I said, I'll work with you. You know, I'll be back. I won't forget about you. I'll be back, and we'll smooth everything out. So I really gave myself permission to be free of the world. Take a vacation from it. That's what it really was. That's what the dream really was. It seemed that psychotics were letting me free, but it was really all those complexes, psychosis, that I trusted myself enough to set myself free from that. At some point, you trust yourself enough that you start seeing the world as sublimely the play of light comes into the world. I believe that's possible. You can do it. That's one way of doing it. The gurus are like that. They say, "We don't have to do anything. I see the world is perfect." They trust themselves enough to see the world's perfect, because they don't have continuity fear. But for us, we can see it just right now, and with less continuity fear, so our experiencing of it becomes different. And again, even to the point we can take a vacation from the world and say, "Well, we'll come back at some things calm down," or take a vacation in this world in some way where you're really not focusing on anything that's taking place in the world. It doesn't matter, because that's not our goal. Our goal is to see, allow the light to appear as it truly is, instead of pretending that it's somehow different, that it's been changed. See, we wanted to change reality so light presented itself as if it were changed. But it's still the same light, just pretending it's changed. It hasn't really changed at all. But yet we don't want to see all light as not changed. So light can come into this dream as, like I said, a little glitter. Beautiful, tiny, like mist, faint mist. And it presents itself as unchanged, not changed. So, you know, can we have our cake and eat it too? Only in this context. Only in this context. But we understand its perception. So within the context of perception, it can seem we can have our cake and eat it too. But only in the context of healing perception, moving us towards dropping perception altogether, ultimately. Only in that context. So it's not a permanent cake and eat it too situation. That's what continuity fear is trying to tell us. We're trying to say, no, we can have both permanently. No, because when we see the light as unchanged, we say, oh my God, all this is just an illusion. So in other words, we can't see illusion as true and also see truth as true. That is not possible. What we can have is, in perception, we see light pretending not to not be light, and light now showing us not pretending to be different. Light pretending to be different, and light not pretending to be different. And then seeing the light not pretending to be different, we then realize, oh, this other was just mere pretense. And then we say, okay, I can allow that to vanish without a trace, and realize it was just pretense. Because when you stop pretending, nothing real has vanished. You're no longer dancing that way. And you can always dance that way again if you want to, right? Yeah. So you're going towards awakening. You're not stalled out in illusion is true and truth is true. That's not what happened. In other words, you're not saying, oh, this beautiful golden light, that's a type of light, and there's this other light that's like the world light. So there's two different lights, and I can have both. That's a lie. Okay, that can never happen like that. You will never see it that way. As long as you want to see it that way, you won't see the true light, the light not pretending to be different than what it is. You won't see it. You'll be terrified of it. You'll be frightened of it. Simple, right? Easy. Obvious. The only thing that makes it not obvious is the dance of continuity fear. You start dancing with concepts, dancing with questions, dancing. You start, you know, doing that dance, and just wow it. Don't do that dance. Just say, I'm gonna do the wow dance. So Holy Spirit says a Hawaiian vacation is coming up for you. What does that mean? I don't really want to go to Hawaii because of all the politics there, the racial politics. It's not a good place, Hawaii. It's not. I mean, they view you're a Hali tourist. spend your money, and then get out of here. So it's really, you know, there's this, are you a local, you know, you had generations of your family here, are you related to somebody, is, and there's sort of uneasy truces there. The natives are very restless there. They want their islands back for themselves. There's a lot of problems in Hawaii. So the Hawaiian vacation is just sort of this metaphor we use for like a very, you know, balmy, peaceful place. Just go somewhere and play golf and relax on the beach and just recover your spirit and feel, you know, free of all political correctness and politics and all this mother worship and all this nonsense. But no, I mean, the idea of going living in Hawaii is a terrible idea. Terrible idea. Awful there. Dangerous, actually. Dangerous place. You can't just be walking on the beach at sunset, you know, just blissed out, you know. No, I mean, hey, the locals will mug you, beat you up and say, you know, get off our island. That's a perfect opportunity for them to, you know, blame their problems on someone else. So it's a very infantile place, Hawaii, actually. Very infantile. Tremendous mother worship going on there. So that's the last place I'd want to go, actually. but what the Holy Spirit was getting to me was the spirit of aloha, spirit of we're relaxed. We're not materialistic. We're enjoying beautiful nature. We're enjoying the beauty of that nature is presenting to us. It's very peaceful. The atmosphere is very beautiful and wonderful. Everything is lush and green, right? We don't have to struggle and strive for nature to be beautiful. That the idea of Hawaii, the myth of Hawaii, is it's some place that's just naturally, so naturally beautiful. Everything's, we don't have to struggle to make it beautiful. Whereas like here, it's such a struggle. You know, this terrible drought in California. I had to let almost everything die here. I used to have like super beautiful gardens here and flowers everywhere. And it's all gone. It's all, everything's gone. Almost everything. It's just stark, it's dry. You know, it's such a struggle here. Everything's a struggle. The idea of Hawaii is no struggle. Man, everything just grows beautiful here by its own, and we're just here enjoying it. That's the idea, you know, of Hawaii. And the water is warm and wonderful and inviting. The waves are gentle. They're beautiful waves. They're gentle waves. Nature is gentle. You know, the idea of gentle glory. There's this tinge of gentle glory everywhere. I spent some time in Hawaii when I was like 2 years old, two, three, four. When we'd go there, that was before I was in school, so we went there before, during the school year. My dad was a superintendent of education for Hawaii. He had a high position there, and we lived in a beautiful mansion, and I was like 2 years old. All I did was play all day long. And then we'd fly back to the mainland for summer, because he was teaching summer classes here or something. So during the school year, he was over in Hawaii helping administer the educational system of Hawaii, and then we'd fly back here during the summer when the school was out, and he did some class, stuff over here in the mainland, worked over here in the mainland. So we did that. So I would spend, you know, maybe eight months. See what it's like. Start maybe September, October, November, December, January, February, March, April, May. Maybe 9 months of the year we'd spend in Hawaii. So I spent 9 months, and then come. So I did that for several years. So I was so young at that point. I was oblivious to all the politics of Hawaii and all the racism and all the stuff that goes on there. It was before it was a state, actually. So it was a much more laid back then, way more laid back. There wasn't so much of the troubles that have come up. The crime and all the stuff. No, it was after the war. Still, you know, it was like very idyllic in Hawaii then compared to now. It's terrible now. From what I hear, I went back once in 1975 on the way to Japan. I stayed there for about a week, 10 days, with some friends who had a beautiful little bungalow right near Diamond Head, right near the beach. You'd walk like 100 yards, and you're on this gorgeous little private beach, looking out over Diamond Head. It was just like gorgeous, beautiful. Stayed there for like 10 days, and then went to Japan, and I haven't been back to Hawaii since. That was 1975. So what about, you know, 40 plus years? But you know, friends, everybody in California goes to Hawaii, and you know, it's, you know, you go to a resort, Hyatt Resort or something, and it's water slides, it's fun, you know, and then you go home. But as far as really living there and stuff, it's not like it was in 1958. And so it was quite idyllic then. So I was just playing with all the, you know, just in shorts, and that's it. You just wear shorts and walk around and maybe sandals, but I'm barefoot most of the time. And the gentle rain, the rainbows, the gentle rain, the beautiful flowers and foliage and glossy, shiny, colorful foliage. And, you know, it was like paradise. My brother went to Punahou private school, like when he was kindergarten. I think he went to kindergarten, preschool, kindergarten there. But I was too young for school, so I had no school. I just played all the time, 24 hours, you know. Whenever I was up, I was just outside playing in Hawaii. That's what I did. And I came back here to California. I said, this is terrible. I want to go back to Hawaii. I hate this. California. It's horrible. Too cold here. Well, it wasn't cold at that time, but it just, where's the rain? Where are the rainbows? You know, where's the glossy foliage? Where's all the beauty, you know? Where are all the tropical flowers? Where are the plumeria blossoms? And then where are the flower lays? And we always had flower lays, flowers everywhere. And so that's the idea of Hawaii. It's just tropical paradise, just flowers everywhere, fragrance everywhere. Nature, gentle. The soft breezes, the soft chimes, you know, the beautiful, soft ukulele music, and and everything, nature is just so gentle and beautiful. And you don't have to do anything to make it that way. It just is that way. That's what I experienced when I was young. I just have a report back from the jungles of Indonesian jungles, Borneo. It's the hottest place in the world, they said. It's just, you know, humidity 90-95%, temperature 95 constantly, just blazingly hot. It's just like you're being fried in a sauna. It's horrible. So that type of jungle is not so cool. Hawaii though is like 78 degrees and soft breeze and, you know, some humidity, but just everything's just so nice, you know. Wow. But I'll take the desert in October or November over Hawaii. I'll take Coachella Valley over Hawaii any day, because there's no humidity and the temperature, everything's, it feels like perfect. You don't even feel your body. It's like easy to just completely forget you even have a body in Coachella Valley. But, you know, it's so expensive there now, is because everybody has these festivals, and, you know, because the rich people discover, they go there and the hotels jack the rates up. So it's like $400, $500 a night. It's crazy. I was looking at hotel prices and it's just I don't know. I guess there's the big rock concert there in this October, but I mean you can't find. It used to be that you could get cheap prices off season when all the kids go back to school. Now it's like it's crazy. $400 a night. 280 at the cheapest or something. What? Used to be you could get like $110. Very nice hotel with breakfast included. Those bargain days seem to have vanished. I mean, it's shocking to me. It's very actually discouraging because Coachella to me is the nicest place in the world, really, Coachella Valley. Anytime, but in the summer, of course, it's too hot for most people. But in the wintertime and springtime, it's just you can you don't even feel, you forget your body exists because the temperature, everything is such that it's just very idyllic. Of course, the wealth, the rich know this. They have their homes, their second homes, and that's one of their secrets. They disappear there whenever they want to. But for some reason, just now, you can't get cheap hotels anymore, good ones. And so that's very discouraging for me, very discouraging. But I always hope that I can somehow take just a short vacation there. Somehow the funds will appear. I don't have the funds, but people help me out. And I'm able to go there occasionally. And so that keeps me like there's some place in the world that is just you could forget about the world. But now it's too expensive, at least. So it's very discouraging. Have to maybe go to a different world. But really, I mean, in just disappearing on one of those golf courses, like Desert Willow, Firecliff or something, Desert Willow. You go there, you keep to tee off, and there's no houses. Suddenly, you're in this tropical this paradise of palm trees and waterfalls and lakes and lush green grass. But it's like winter. It's like December, and it's like 82 degrees. And you're in like some shorts and Aloha shirt or something. I mean, you just look around, and everything's lush and green and shining and clean, and the lakes are sparkling. And for a while, you utterly forget about the world. You're so happy. You say, oh, there's still some place like this. I can get away from the world. And so for 5 hours or so, you just, and then you come in, then you finish, you eat some food, you relax, go to a nice hotel where there's, beautiful palm trees, and you forget about the world. And it's just like, it's the most wonderful thing to do. Now, in meditation, we're trying to do that. But I prefer the 360-degree literally experiencing of this like this. It's very intense in terms of, in meditation, it's like you can forget about the world, so to speak, but you still know that when you come out of it, you're still in this terrible world, this terrible place, and all the problems and stuff. But it's more powerful when you're actually moving around fully, functioning in terms of doing stuff, and you still feel you've left the world. I mean, that is more powerful for me. And hitting a golf ball is just an excuse to get out there. That's all it is. I don't care about my score. I just feel like I can belong here because I can hit the golf ball. But I'm just out there to just drive around and just oh, wow. Look at all these flowers. In wintertime, I mean, in wintertime, all the flowers are blooming there. It's perfect. Everywhere you look, there's flowers. And it's usually winter's desolate here, it's dry, desolate. And you go there and suddenly you're like just flowers, but you don't have the problem of the tropical heat and humidity. And the people there, being most on vacation, there's not all these these politics and racism there. Okay, so you don't get that racist vibe that you're not welcome here. No, we're all just tourists here, and everyone in the hotel, everyone's welcome each other, and you know, it's just like the greatest attitude ever there. And people of all races go there, and there isn't this racist vibe there at all. I've never experienced it. Everyone's happy about the beauty, the gentle beauty there. Everyone feels it, pretty much everyone. Yeah, and if anything happens, it's only the Holy Spirit getting your attention in some way, right? As it is everywhere, but it's amazing. When I went to Antelope Poppy Preserve in that 100-year bloom in like 2002, maybe, or 2002, there are people from all over the world there, all different races, cultures, countries, etc. You know what? It was so beautiful. The gentle glory was so beautiful there that everybody forgot about their country, their culture, their race, everything. And we were all just smiling at each other. Everyone was just smiling at each other. Okay? So I've had this experience. That was more powerful. It was a very powerful experience. See, this is the kind of experience that's really powerful. It's more powerful than meditation. And I crave that type of experience. Is you're in a place that's so beautiful, you just forget all everything else, and it trumps your aggravations, you know. Nobody was aggravated. The poppies are so beautiful. The air was just scented like honey, this beautiful scent of poppies, billions of poppy flowers, and everyone was so intoxicated. I couldn't even drive. I was so happy and people, nobody could drive. I mean, I got to pull over. I got to stop. Get out. And then we're just wandering around like, completely forgetting about some linear agenda, causality. I mean, we weren't even walking in straight lines. We were kind of like, walking this way. We completely forgot about, you know, I'm supposed to be a robot. It's like everywhere we turn, it's so beautiful. It's so beautiful here, so beautiful here. Oh my God, I'm immersed in it. It was like an immersive feeling. It was the most awesome thing. I went back the next year and it had a good bloom. And the next year, I think it was like 2003. And then 2004 had some also. It's been lousy ever since, actually. It's been really not good at all. And I think this year they had nothing. Maybe this year you'll have a big bloom. But that was a super, extremely profound experience that I realized that the gentle glory of perception can be such that we really just can smile at one another, and for no reason at all except the gentle glory, we all are experiencing it. We don't need to say anything. We know why we're smiling. We don't need to say, why? It's like someone doesn't come up to you and say, why are you laughing and smiling? Can you explain this to me? It seems very crazy to me. I'm feel nervous. Nobody comes up to you and says that. If they do, they're the ones that are obviously crazy. You just ignore them. Because it's completely obvious why everybody's laughing and smiling. Because there's billions of poppies everywhere. And the whole air is scented. And the sky is blue and beautiful. It's 78 degrees. And it's like, we're just, of course, you know, nobody asks that question. Nobody's that crazy. If they are, you know, you probably need to stay away from the place. Because you're aggravating people by asking that question. So the light can, when our continuity fear is diminished enough, it can present itself in such a way as if there's billions of beautiful poppies everywhere, so to speak. There's billions of dots of light, of this living light everywhere. But then, of course, people will ask us, why are you smiling? Why are you act this way? I don't see you know, all these poppies. So that's a problem, isn't it? So they think you're crazy. So it might be better, intermediate step might be go to a world that's just gorgeously beautiful. And so people just feel this like, I got what I want. I'm immersed in this gentle glory. Wow. Now, in California, it used to be that way before everybody, the greed got a hold of it too badly. Whereas we would be smiling and say, hey, hi, how you doing? And nobody asks you, why are you so happy? We'd be giggling or something. Nobody asks you why you're so happy, because we're like hanging out in SoCal on this gorgeous day. It's so gorgeous. And we were all just giddy and drinking lemonade and laughing because it's like so beautiful. Nobody asks you why you're this way. And I still meet people like my age, and even I met someone, a younger person, and we'd just be smiling, and we looked at each other, and we kind of just said, wow, what a day, huh? What a beautiful day. And I say, yeah. I always say, California dreaming on such a beautiful day, huh? And we just look at each other and just nod and laugh. Say, yeah. And say, she said, the cashier said, have a beautiful, beautiful day. I said, yeah. I will, for sure. You know that? And I said, yeah. Because it was such a beautiful day. It was such a gorgeous, shining, beautiful day. We don't need to explain. You know, just, you know, be happy. I know you're going to be laughing and happy today because it's such a gorgeous day. So this was California. This is why I came here. Is I didn't want to explain. Why do I feel good? Because it's, what do you mean, why do I feel so good? How fortunate we are to be experiencing this, you know, sublime weather and vegetation is, you know, so beautiful here when there's rain and, you know, everything's being watered. That's why people refuse to stop watering their yards. That's their baby. That's how they retreat to their patio and their yard, and they want to feel that the world doesn't exist anymore. Everybody wants to feel the world doesn't exist anymore, right? So what Jesus told us is that you can ask the living light to present within your perception, even while you're still in this world, this beautiful play of light for you. He says, and it will do so. So I asked the light to do this for me. And I realized continuity fear will delay it a little bit. But the problem then is that people will think you're crazy. So, they will. That is a problem. That's why most people don't do that. They don't do it. Nobody wants to be seen as crazy here. Of course not. Very few are like Ananda My Ma, who she'd say, look, I know you all think I'm totally crazy, or not, at least got severe mental retardation. She said, that's okay. If you want to see me that way, that's fine. I have no problem with that. Very rarely is anyone like that here. But she had to bring it right out in the open. She brought it right out in the open. She says, look, I'm in total bliss, and you're all wondering, why is she like that? We don't see the reason for it. So she must be mentally retarded. Sometimes mentally retarded people kind of like, they can seem, you know, like, to be like just happy for no reason. Like, oh, maybe they're not mentally retarded. Who knows, right? Maybe they are in bliss, but maybe not. But so she just said, yeah, you know, people think that maybe I have a mental problem. That's okay. She says, maybe I do. But doesn't bother me at all. So she was able to handle this like supremely well, but we're not able to handle it to that supremely well to that extent. Totally unrealistic to expect that of ourselves. So even if you go to Hawaii or Coachella, if you're in this blissful seeing the living light, people will think you're crazy. Because they say, yeah, I see the flowers, they're beautiful, but they're not that beautiful. Right? So that's just a step. You know, I've experienced Hawaii, okay? I know it when I was young, to the ultimate extent. I experienced the very best of Hawaii. We lived in Aiea Heights above Honolulu in a mansion up on top of the hill. And we'd go down to, you know, the swimming places there. And what's that? So I experienced Hawaii. I've experienced the beauty of nature in many ways of sublimely beautiful. And that antelope poppy preserve was, you know, as gorgeous as you're ever going to see nature. Okay. That really blew our minds. That made a lasting impression. I mean, it was so absolutely shockingly beautiful. What can I say? Unforgettable. That's the best that nature can do, really. And then I went searching for something as good, but that's, you know, it was like, you know, as good as it gets. It's up in that echelon of mind, blowing your mind. Now, there may be other ways you can blow your mind, Grand Canyon or something or stuff. That's fine. But, you know, my mind, our minds were blown to the extent we forgot all about the world and everything else, and we were just smiling at one another. And that's the goal. So we're not going to judge which is better. It reached the goal for me. All right, it reached the goal. It provided the experience that was needed. And then Coachella Valley, I've had many experiences there of again having my mind just blown, just like I'm just can't help but be happy, you know, for no reason. It's just everything was so beautiful. playing a golf course down there in it was December, was it? Early January or something. We were down there for Christmas. And they everything was immaculate. All the flowers were planted. The water, that was before the drought. All the waterfalls and rivers and lakes were flowing. And the grass was like completely immaculate. They had overseeded it. One of the times was I was like one of the first persons out on the course where they'd overseeded and everybody had been off the course for a month. And it was immaculate. There's no evidence of human having been there. They'd overseeded with ryegrass and for the winter, and it just blew my mind. And so Coachella has blown my mind many times. That area, I don't go there for the festivals and all that nonsense. Okay, what nonsense to go there for that? But if they want to do that, okay, they're trying to have their cake and eat it too. But no, it's the stillness. It's just beauty just as it is. No, I don't need to add a bunch of music and dancing, all that kind of stuff to it. No. Summertime there, 113 degrees. When I teed off, maybe it reached 114, 115 while I was playing. Just sit there still and just listen to the cricket, all the insects, and the hum and the vibe of the heat and the lushness and beauty, and just don't do anything. Coachella has just blown my mind in so many ways. And I thank it from the bottom of my heart. You know, my grandmother lived there since the late 50s, early 60s. She lived there. And then my uncle lived there from the 60s all the way through to the 2000s. So, you know, I had family in that area. And we'd go down there and visit them. And I always loved the desert. It was so beautiful. The contrast and everything, gosh, and it's just, you know, it's just absolutely loved Coachella Valley more than any place in the world, for sure. And but now it's too expensive, you know, and it's always too expensive. But even, you know, the meager help that I get, you know, I can't, you know, I don't know how I'm going to afford it at all. So maybe there's some place better than Coachella Valley. Maybe it's some other world, actually. I could handle it. You know, I'm one of those who can handle it. I'm ready for that. Gentle glory. The Buddhists know there's pure lands, many pure lands that fulfill this function for us. And we may very well ascend, actually, at this point, in some way. We're told that ascension will happen at the end of this age, and we're at it right now. There's no question about it. We're ready to regress into infantilism and mother worship. And that's just totally unacceptable for someone like myself. Completely unacceptable. I've matured. But once you mature, you don't go back to infantization. Okay, when you spiritually mature, you don't go back, lapse back into that. That just, you know, cannot happen. You would be an absolute misfit. Absolute misfit. So I feel like I'm going to be an absolute misfit in society and culture going forward here. Absolute misfit. And there are others like me, right? That you feel I'm going to be an absolute misfit. So I'm asking the gurus, okay, guru, look, I'm an absolute misfit. I mean, I can't go around saying I'm seeing the living light, you know, sparkling everywhere. People will say you're crazy. You need to put you on drugs. I don't feel there's this culture that allows that. I mean, the whole hippie thing back in the '60s was they it wasn't allowed to do that, so they had to have an excuse. So they used drugs, and they say, "Well, they're on drugs." You know, that was their excuse. "I'm seeing all these lights, man. I'm seeing all this play of lights and stuff." Well, that wasn't really the living light in the way that Jesus talks about it, but they were trying to get to it. But it was so forbidden that they had to have an excuse. So, "Oh, yeah, we're using drugs. We're dropping acid, and we're seeing this stuff." But that had many very bad consequences, actually. So that's not going to be done. I'm not going to do that at all. There's no way. I'm not going to use an excuse or a crutch, because that is really has drastically bad side effects, consequences. So may have to go somewhere else where everyone, can accept that, or experience the beautiful nature, or experience somewhere where people are advanced enough they realize you're seeing the living light, and they allow for that too. I don't know where that is. But you rarely, if ever, hear anybody talking like this in this world. I wish there was more, but maybe I'm literally telling you, you can ask the light to present itself, and you will see this golden, in your perception, you will see this like unbelievably beautiful arrays of the living light. Not taking any drugs at all. It's not drug-based at all. So there's no side effects at all to it. Who do you hear, speaking like that? "No, it's all about ethnogens, man. You need to take ethnogens, and you need to, turn on to this, and man, to..." No, you don't. That's not it at all. That's infantilization, mother worshiping stuff. It's not really being honest, okay? It's not really. It's a crutch. It's a dishonest crutch that's refusing to see itself in such a light. So in infantile mother worshiping society, drugs are allowed, but nothing else. You can't actually tell the light this is what you want to see, and it presents itself to you in this gorgeous play of light that Jesus tells us that's what we can do. So I trust in Jesus and what he has told me. And no, it's not myopic photo stuff by pressing your eyeballs, or the buzzing of your brain. And no, it's not any of that. Okay, the materialists will always come up with some explanation that tries to explain it away, because they're terrified of their own empowerment. They want to believe that the light is no longer the light. It's electromagnetism, they think now. No, it's all electromagnetism. It's just a play of electromagnetism. No, it's not. Electromagnetism is light pretending that it's been changed from what it really is, and it hasn't change from what it is. It's only pretending, and we need to start experiencing it in a non-pretending way, right? So that we get drop our evaporate our continuity fear more. We've got to keep evaporating our continuity fear more. It's either that or mental illness. You choose which one. That's the choice. We either choose mental illness or the discipline of evaporating our continuity fear. That's the only two options we have right now. The third option is to drop. Leap into full empowerment in this instant, and nobody is going to do that. All right, and if you're the one out of trillions and trillions and trillions that does that, you don't care what I say at all, because you'll do it right anyway. You've already done it. Okay, so nobody is going to do that. So the option is between mental illness and the discipline of evaporating continuity fear. There's no other option at all. No other option at all. And the mentally ill, of course, they keep dreaming of there's some other option. And that's mental illness. Not seeing your options and imagining that there's some option that doesn't exist is mental illness. And expecting that you can do the impossible, basically. It's not that you can, when everything, all your fear is insisting you don't, drop all fear this instant. That's mental illness too. That's unrealistic, totally unrealistic. Totally unrealistic. So believing that you can do what you can't do, which you are not going to do that, and putting all your hope that you can do what you're not going to do is hope and fear, is mental illness. So when you accept you have a severe continuity problem, then you're saying, "Look, I know I'm not going to get free of fear for a while. It's not going to happen. But I know I can diminish it." Right? That's mental health. That's mental health. So all praise to Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, who explained this to me. No one else explained this to me, really. He's the one that explained all this to me. Now, within the traditions of the gurus, Dharma Kings, that's explained, but it's explained to the close devotees, the close disciples. Within Samaya, it's not talked about outside of that. So, I'm sure they're completely aware of all this. But Jesus was the one that openly expressed it in A Course in Miracles, so that we could actually study and read it. You know, that's great. But not many understand this from what he even he's very plain about it. Still, they cherry pick what they, you know, and keep thinking it's about something else. It's about that too, but it's about all of it. And this vision of the light is extremely important. He says you will reach a phase where your continuity fears diminish to enough so that you will accept this play of light. And this, then he said, that is super helpful for you. You will realize once you reach that stage that you really are going to succeed. There's no question about it. You'll really enjoy that phase, he says, very much so. And then your progress will be quite rapid at that point in terms of easy. It'll be quite easy, let's say. Rapid scares people. The easement will come. There'll be this great easement that will come to you. And great confidence will come to you. Confidence and easement. Confidence and easement will arrive for you. So we're at a great time now. I'm celebrating. Let's celebrate these times, because the Dharma Kings are going to do something. They made it plain to me. I was at the seaside there, praying to Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, and Jamyang Kinsi Lodro. They're, of course, totally aware of the Pure Lands. That's very much a part of Buddha's teaching. They're totally aware of these sublime realms. Padmasambhava dwells in the most sublime realm of them all, or one of the few, one, two, or three most sublime realms of all. He's the presence there. Copper-covered mountain, colored mountain, they call it, or something. It's so sublime that there's no way to even explain it. He is the principal presence there, Padmasambhava. So he's. Yeah, and Longchenpa said he's going to, when he left this world, he's going to go to, you know, extremely sublime realm and help out there. And Jesus Christ said he started going to the kingdom of heaven. These are the sublime realms. And Manjushri is the gentle glory, which is the empowerment of all these sublime realms. Okay, so we're totally connected to the sublime realms here. Totally connected. So I prayed to them, and they sent me those four pelicans flying across the sun, showing that they're going somewhere past the electromagnetic spectrum. And then they talked about the green light that flashes from the sun as it's setting. So as electromagnetic, the presence of electromagnetism, the sun, as just as it's setting, there's a point where you can get, where you can experience something different light from it, a different light, a green light. And then they showed up just to show me right at the right instant, the right moment, they will show up. Those who are totally aware of the sublime realms, totally aware. And they're saying, my house is your house. They've made it very clear to me, I'm totally welcome there. My casa es tu casa. Mi casa es tu casa. And they've gone out of their way to reassure me that I'm totally welcome there. In a sublime, gentle glory realm, gentle glory experience. Now, it still can be experienced here in this world, but they'll think you're crazy. This is the problem. This is the problem we're up against here. And you might, you know, Ananda my Ma is trying to, you know, get help from her. How can you be, you know, truly experience the light in this world? They'll think you're crazy. And so I was trying to see how, from her, how do you do it? But, you know, it she was, you know, the perfect master at it. And even then, you know, it was relentless. They were relentless. And she, at some point, you know, the people just started to get tired of her in terms of they couldn't bend her to their will. So they kind of started thinking, yeah, you're wonderful, but we're going to, you know, we're going to look somewhere else at some point because we thought you could change the reality, but you're not for us. And you're strict and tell us to practice and stuff. And we just, you know, so they started, and so they started to lose interest in her. And that's when she seemed to withdraw from the world. It started in the mid-70s, I think. When she was about 70 years old, like 1968, or maybe a little older, when she was maybe 74, 1972, I think then she seemed to change, seemed to be really detached from the world, not so engaged. That's because people started looking elsewhere, started looking to what? Technology. So when we started to get the whiff of technology, which was started in about 1972 or something, I know 81, I think, was what the first PC, IBM PC came out. But I remember calculators came out in about 1972 or 3, because I was still in high school and people were getting calculators. I never got one. That was 1972 or 3. That's when people started becoming interested in technology, and that's when Ananda Mai Ma seemed to lose some of her luster here in the world. Because we were basically saying, we've kind of had thanks, but we're going to go in a different direction. And so the way she was is she was just like a rag doll. If we weren't interested in what she had to for us, then she would just become pretty much inert. So she started looking like pretty inert at that point and less engaged, because you look in the mirror, she says, as you look, see me. As you play the instrument, so you hear the tune. So the world stopped being interested in her, and then so the sound started to be less. I noticed looking back, I saw that's how it was. But the world was really asking for help and willing, then she was just, you know, this completely fabulousness, total fabulousness. But that wasn't there then after 1972. It started, that wasn't there as much at all. Because we kind of said, hey, you know what, it's probably time for you to start dying. And so she started dying. Didn't have to. She said, if you want me to stay, I'll stay. If you want me to be young, I'll be young. But the people said, no, we've got a new interest. It's this technology. We want to see what we can do with technology. And so she faded out of the picture. But she told us very clearly, I don't need to. Not at all. But that's what you want. So I neither want to stay or go. Neither one. Doesn't matter. I'm everywhere anyway. But if you don't want this appearance, then the appearance will disappear for you. The body's just an appearance. But if you don't want that, it'll disappear. It'll die. But if you do want it, it will stay. It's up to you. Now, if we want the appearance to her to reappear, she could reappear, sure. But we don't want that right now, do we? For me, if she reappears for me, I say, okay. Let's see how useful that is. But as far as reappearing for the world, that's probably not going to happen. That's what I wanted to happen, but it hasn't happened. So she said she would reappear, but I was trying to insist it was for the world. She says, no, it's for you. I'll reappear for you because you want me to. For the genuine, for the right reason. But the world doesn't want me to appear right now. So I'm okay with that. So I couldn't force her hand in that way. So that's okay. But I can have her appear for me. She'll appear for me if I ask her to. Because I understand it's just all a play of appearance. And the dynamics of existence have no effect on her at all. If she, or whatever appearance, she can appear. If someone asks her to, she'll appear. If it's for the right reason. And it may be to help usher us into a sublime realm. As I've said, I've had dreams of going into a sublime realm, and it was very easy. just drove the vehicle right into it. I didn't have to lose my vehicle at all. See, I don't believe that going to a sublime realm, you lose your vehicle. You don't need to at all. And in my dreams, I've gone there, and I kept my vehicle. I drove my car into that realm. In other words, that's a symbolic of keeping your body. Don't need to drop your body. So if Ananda Maima reappeared, which I believe she will, if I ask her to, she will. And will I take pictures of her and present her to the devotees? No. She showed me that doesn't work, because the devotees are still in mother worship of expecting her to change reality for them. And this will just fire them up even more. It's like, oh, yeah. No, they're not interested in what she's really about. It's hard to accept, but it's true. So the real devotees who listened to what she had to say and appreciated what she had to help us, who've been practicing and evaporating their continuity fear, then she can appear to them. Absolutely. And I believe she will. You might even say, I know she will. Keep in mind, this is a super guru. This is a Dharma King, super guru. Anything, they have no limitations. No limitations whatsoever. But the idea of saying, oh, you need to be presented to the world, everybody's going to say how wonderful. No, they're right back into mother worship. Oh, good, you're here about to change reality. Great, so we don't have to worry about our empowerment, you know, that we're all powerful. We can keep believing that we're just little limited human beings, but stay that way and be happy with that. Oh, thank you so much, you know. That's the problem. So I've gone through this experience recently of realizing devotees, you know, are just hoping for that. They just want to have their, you know, belief in the mother goddess glamorized and made beautiful so that they can keep worshiping and her and petitioning her to change reality. I don't see any evidence that they're listening to what she really said, they're really practicing intensely. Like Jesus said, just don't go, Jesus, 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 hell, Jesus, Jesus. Practice what I told you. Practice evaporating your condition of fear. Wow the clarity that arises. You have to wow the clarity that arises. There'd be evidence. If they're wowing the clarity that arises, there'd be evidence of that. But I speak openly on Facebook, for instance, nobody, you know, other than the few that are getting it, nobody says anything. I say, what? Really? Well, they haven't been practicing very well then. Because if you've been practicing evaporating your cognitive fear, you are going to be able to hear what's being said here and resonate with it. It's a wow, for sure. It's like, wow, this is very intense. But you're not going to be freaked out. You're not going to become infantile. You're not going to go into mother worship. You're going to say, you know what? Great. I'm happy to hear this. So let me consider this within the context of my practice. That's called spiritual maturity. That's called spiritual maturity. That means you've been working at it the right way. Congratulations. It's going to get better and better for you. But we're going to still wow it. So when you go to that poppy, like when I went to that poppy reserve, holy cow. That caught me off guard, I'll tell you. I had no idea. I just heard there's a bunch of flowers down there, and I went down there. I said, I had no idea what to expect. It caught me off guard. It just, you know, it was just so astonishing, actually. So astonishing. Where did all these flowers come from? You got to be kidding me. Out of nowhere, almost, right? Ordinary, you go through, it's desolate. And now it's just this golden carpet, you know, it's just, what? It's still astonishing to this day, but wonderfully so. But I had the capacity to handle that. I was used to being astonished by hanging out with Ananda Mahima, her videos, her pictures, her the books about her, and just the dreams I had of her, so many dreams. I was so used to, you know, it's like being astonished by beauty and the sublime, that I was ready for that. So we may be ready for an entire world that's sublime at this point, actually. I believe I am. I believe I'm ready for an entire world, a realm that is sublime. That would be the next, you know, could be the next step. It's all sublime. Naturally so, without us having to do anything about it. No maintenance required. No work, no maintenance required. Isn't that great? Wow, weather's changing here. It's no longer so nice. You see, so we're actually going to get some cool weather for the next week or so. Not, you know, windy, cloudy, cool, some rain possible, and you know, it'll be wonderful fall weather here. But it's not so nice. Trying to see what I can do as far as taping to help us out. But really, I'm just trying to keep us all encouraged and normalize our path. Like, yeah, we could see the light. Of course we can. Can Ananda Mahima appear for me? Absolutely. That wouldn't cause me a problem. I would wow it, but it's like, yeah. But I'd accept that wouldn't be a problem for me. I wouldn't think I'm crazy at all. It would be no different than her appearing in India. They just wanted to see her go through a birth and a death, you know, so they could feel comfortable that she would disappear. So they wanted to believe that she was born. But she said she never identified with the born body at all. Body consciousness, never identified it with it whatsoever. They just wanted to see it that way. I don't need to see it that way. I don't need to see her be born in order for her to appear for me. I have no desire for that at all. I could care less about being born. You see, the reason why I wanted to see her being born is they could believe that she would die. So it was that caveat that they allowed her to appear. Because they realized, okay, this isn't going to last forever. She's going to die. Okay, so I'll handle as much as I can now. It was a safety net for them. That's perfectly okay. I mean, kudos for them for allowing that. But that's not really the ultimate at all. I mean, it's better to have the guru just appear without any birth. That's much better. That's much higher way. It's much less continuity fear involved. Because that means if they weren't born, they're just appearing, they could appear, go on, keep appearing forever, right? Or appear anytime they want, right? Right? So you have access to them all the time. Whereas if they think you're going to die, well, we're going to lose access to her, but that's okay. At least we have her statues now. And yes, my statue, pranam to ma, which is wonderful. I mean, that's okay. I'm not putting the devotees down. It's a phase. It's a phase. But there's a lot of continuity fear involved with that phase, a lot. And they eventually, they've got to get over that phase. And Ananda Mahima helped me through that. She said, okay, dump me for a while. She said, I want you to dump me. And I did. And that was fine. I was okay. And not a problem. I was able to get help from Ron Maharshi, Longchenpa, Jesus Christ, you know, different ways. The other Dharma Kings, you know, and get very comfortable with them. Went back to Journey Beyond Words, did a lot of life experiencing and taping. Yeah, it's fine. I'm fine with that. So, but the idea that someone disappears, the only way they can do it is to die, is ridiculous. That's continuity fear generates that. No, they just, appearance is appearance. They can appear or disappear. They don't need to die to disappear. It's ludicrous. These are just light pixels, so to speak. It's a living light. You want to appear some other way? You want to appear visible to sensory perception? You can appear visible. You want to appear invisible to sensory perception? You can do that, like that. It's just a light. Just a play of light. I have some ideas for some new video projects, actually. I'm working on one. I'm having trouble. It keeps getting more sublime, you know. I don't know how to put a storyline into it. Maybe I'll just do a 360 degree video for you where there is no storyline, and or the storyline just kind of evaporates in this into the sublime, you know. Cali Ross is searching for Juan Carlos, and then suddenly there's something very sublime happens, you know, like, oh, we forgot what's going on. Oh, that's okay. Maybe that's the storyline for the video. I keep having these vignettes of the stuff that's just so gorgeous and beautiful and sublime, but I say, how do I tie that into like a linear story? And I say, I can't really. I don't know. Maybe don't do it. Just these beautiful, sublime snippets. Maybe that's what we need right now. I think I'm good at this. Okay, so if you're up for that, I'm very good at just putting these little mini beautiful snippets together. And so it's not some story. You know, that's old-fashioned. I mean, there's a lot of continuity fear in that, actually. But when you evaporate, you don't need a story. You don't need a story. You just, the sublime. Oh, this is really sublime. Oh, this is really sublime. Oh, this is really sublime. Oh, this is. Hey, I don't need a story. Okay, but I weave just sort of a loose story of where's Juan Carlos? I'm searching for Juan Carlos. Carl Cali Ross is searching for Juan Carlos. Or Juan, you know, he's and we keep stumbling onto the sublime. And we feel, well, I don't really need to find Juan Carlos. I mean, the sublime is like the sublime, or maybe I will, but maybe he's here right now, or maybe this is part of Juan Carlos, this sublimeness, okay? You get it? So I'm very good at that. I'm not good at telling a story. So those people who want a story, that there's a lot of continuity if you're involved in that. And I know there's some of you that enjoy just the sublimeness, a few. And, you know, and I invite more of you to make this shift and say, let me just wow the sublimeness of these little vignettes. I mean, that's what I got. I'm saying, what do I do with all that? I couldn't get a story here. I keep thinking, what's wrong with me? Maybe that's the grace that God was giving me, is just these sublime vignettes and weaving this. I have a lot of that kind of stuff. If you're willing for that, willing to do that, but very few watch it. They're still hooked into causality, of, you know, of disempowerment. Like, so what's the causality of disempowerment again? I'm having a hard time. You know, I keep getting attracted to the sublime, and I lose the storyline of disempowerment. I got to get back to that. You know, don't worry. The continuity fear will keep you weaving some vague storyline, okay, but it's just a search for Juan Carlos is a vague storyline, okay. Juan Carlos is here to help us with this. Okay, so the little storyline, where in the world is Juan Carlos? I don't know, it's the search for Juan Carlos. But as we do that, oh my God, it's so beautiful. Oh my God, this is nice. Oh, so beautiful. And then, wow, the beauty that we're getting. He said, Juan Carlos is just allowing himself to be used to provide this sort of loose fabric of a storyline. So we got Juan Carlos and Cali Ross. Cali Ross is searching for Juan Carlos. So you can accept this storyline, and you say, aha. And as we just allow that storyline to just be there, that's just a loose fabric within which we allow the sublime to be experienced. You get this? And this prepares us for the pure realms, the sublime realms. And we may very well be able to go there without dropping our vehicles at all. Very much so. Now, if I see an eye to my mom, she's going to be the one that's weeping. I would certainly weep, but she would be the one that's weeping because she's so doggone happy for the maturity to be able to, you know, to get to this maturity. It's not easy. It's easy if you just work at it every day. I mean, you'll get there for sure. I just trusted it that I'll get there for sure if I just work at it every day. That's the secret to it. You know, can't stop me. Can't stop any one of you. If you work at it every day, you're unstoppable. You're unstoppable. I know this. I'm not nothing special. I'm unstoppable just like you are. If you work out every day, you will be unstoppable. Only problem we have is continuity fear. You just work out every day, you're evaporating your problem. How could anyone possibly be surprised that you start having less and less issues with the sublime? Of course, you'll have less issues with the sublime. Only insanity could fail to see that, right? If there's only one problem and you've diminished that problem, and this problem is preventing you from experiencing the sublime, as you diminish it, of course you're going to be more and more comfortable with the sublime. It's a no-brainer, an absolute no-brainer. And those who don't see that are in a state of, you know, mental illness. No question about it. As I say, you either choose mental illness or you choose to work on your, evaporate your continuity fear. It's the only choice we have. And so she will appear. I was shown in a dream she will appear. There's no question about it. And the time is now. When Hillary Clinton's elected president, she will appear. There's no doubt about it. I was shown in a dream that 44 was going to put the gun to us, put the gun to my head, which is the guy in the White House right now. And then on his side behind him was this woman. And when he failed to crush me, she got really, really mad at him, furious with him. She says, you know, I'll do it. You know, so I could tell that she was the next one. She was then going to crack the whip. And then she said, okay, we're going to put him in re-education camps. So I was being taken to a re-education camp by this woman. And that's Hillary Clinton. So she's 45, you know, the 45th president after 44. So 44 failed. Because actually he's not as vicious as 45. You know, 44 is got some severe problems. But he's not as severe as 45. There's, you know, a little bit of light there, like, you know. But 45 is going to be very autocratic. Very dictatorial. You know, you don't mess with mom. Okay, 45 is like dad trying to do what mom told him to do, but there was still a little bit of dad in him, and so he listened to me and he said, okay, so you don't want to die. Yeah, okay, huh? Whereas 45, no. He says, look, I'm the mother, you're the infant, and you're going to do what I say, and you got no say in it. You know how mothers are with infants. You know, they decide to do something. The infant's got no choice, right? They're going to do it. And they like that, right? So 45 is going to put us in re-education camps. But Nanda My Ma is going to appear to those who want to be saved from that. And she's going to help save us from that, help mother us into the sublime realms. Help assist us. Help sister us into the sublime realms. You could say that too. Help friend us into the sublime realms. Help friend us into the experiencing of the sublime, whether it's another realm, whether it's here. But we will experience the sublime. She will see to it for sure. She has our backs on that. I can tell you this for sure. So don't panic. Don't panic. 45. I mean, 45 is gunning for you. Because Ananda My Ma has our back. And she doesn't care if everybody calls her crazy. It doesn't affect her at all. So in other words, her capacity hasn't been limited in any way by this world insisting that her appearing would be completely crazy, totally insane, you know, doesn't face her in the slightest bit. I trust in that. I got to trust in that. She'd say, fine. You can vilify me all you want. I'm not abandoning my brothers in spirit. I'm not abandoning those who have really prepared properly, you know, the genuine yogins. I don't abandon the yogins and the genuine yogins and yoginis. We'll just use the one term, yogins, to cover gender neutral. I'm not abandoning the yogins. I don't abandon yogins. Okay. You can vilify me as the worst person in history forever if you want to, but I don't abandon the yogins under any circumstances. The genuine yogins are not abandoned. So I'm a genuine yogin. Means put in the effort to evaporate continuity fear. Sustained, steady, determined effort to do so. So she does not abandon them under no matter what the pressure is. And we'll find out if this is true. I know she won't, but we'll get to find out directly this is so. But the external devotees, they won't understand this very well. So maybe some will. I doubt it, though. I don't know. But I'm not going to hold my breath on that at all. I'm not counting on it in the slightest bit. So when these Dharma Kings appear in dreams or appear in the world, that means you're a genuine yogin. You are a genuine yogin. And you have to accept this. It's so I'm working on that. I work on that. I have to come to that acceptance that I'm a... is this recording? I hope so. Maybe it hasn't recorded at all. Oh, it is. Oh, wow. We've been recording for 2 hours and 50... Oh, wow. I had no idea how long I've been recording. I lost track of time completely. I'm not even thinking of time. It's just straight from the heart, so to speak. From the core here. Core of compassion. From a genuine yogin. I never called it yoga. I don't do yoga. Right? But what I do is evaporate continuity fear. But that's what real yoga is, actually. In so many words, that's what it's all about. We only have one problem. So it's about working on that problem, about evaporating that problem. Nothing. What else could it be about? Has to be about that. Now, is her appearance in the world, will it counter Hillary Clinton? Obviously, yes. You know, to what extent and how it works, I don't know. You cannot understand how the Dharma Kings work. We cannot. It's 360 degrees. But certainly it will counter Hillary Clinton, the Clintons. Most certainly it will counter it. And it will happen. It will happen. Either before the election or after election, it will happen. It will be countered. The Clintons will be countered. To be sure, they will. Mother worship will be countered. To reject Nanda Maimao is difficult because they think that she's the mother too. They're to be rejecting the mother. So it puts them in a bind, doesn't it? Yeah. It kind of stops them in their tracks. They have difficulty with that. That's why she protects the yogins from falling into infantile mother worshipping. So, either sometime before the election or sometime after the election, Anandamayi is going to show up in some way. It's going to maybe appear, may very well appear, actually. And to me, that's no problem. I don't have any problem with that. Yogins would not have any problem with that. They'd say, what took you so long? I got to wait for the right moment, okay? I said, okay, but, you know, we missed you, to say the least. What, 34 years? She's been gone 34 years. So we've missed you. Greatly missed here. Extremely missed. Because she's the great champion of yogins. The great champion. A great champion. She put them higher than herself, you know. She said, no, you're it. You're it. And she paid homage, you know, to the yogins. She paid homage to them. You know, she'd go around paying homage to them. And they all said, no, we should pay homage to you. She says, no. Don't see me as the mother. Let me pay homage to you. They said, no, let us set you up with a shrine and a statue and flowers. We'll worship you as the mother. She goes, I'm not here for that. Let me pay homage to you. Because you're the ones that are doing the tough work and getting the job done, right? Me, I've never had any continuity. I've never identified with disempowerment at all. So it's all easement for me. But you, it's very tough for you. So let me pay homage to your efforts. See me as your little daughter, or little child, or your sister, or your friend. But let me come and pay homage to you. Let me thank you for your efforts. You know. They said, No, Mama. No. So the genuine yogins, they understood that. Said, okay, thank you. So I am a genuine yogin. I have to accept that. The Dharma Kings have insisted upon it. They say, no, don't you dare think that you're not. We won't let you. We will not let you. I say, yeah, but I don't know all these special meditations. They say, you know, it's not how you evaporate your cognitive fear. It's that you actually do it. So you could do it in many ways. It's the doing of it that's important, not the style of how you do it. Okay, there's quite a few styles, really, so many styles. What's important is that you do it, and so you're actually doing it. That's what's important. That's a yogin. The yogin is the one who's actually doing it, not the one who's professing all these knowledge about different styles. No, the one who's actually found a style and then doing it through that style. Or if they want to employ different styles, that's fine, but, you know, it's the one who's actually doing it is the yogin. No, it's difficult to suffer because I never see myself in that way. I see myself as very inferior to all these wise pundits who seem to know so much about spirituality, you know. It's just like, huh, I know so much, you know. So, I don't know. What do I know? All I know is to wow my success and evaporate the cognitive fear. That's all I know. So I better just keep doing that because that's all I know how to do. The story again I've told many times of these Christian monastic monks on this remote island, and the bishop heard that they'd, you know, forgotten, or they weren't doing all the there's some style that the Roman Catholic Church has taught, so the bishop had to go travel there to set them straight. So he came and said, this is how we do it. Do it this way. This is the style we do it. And do it this way. Okay, that's the style. You got it? They say, oh, thank you, bishop, so much. And so the bishop was leaving in a boat back to the mainland, and suddenly hears a commotion. He looks back, and he sees these monks running across the water to the boat. And they run up to the boat, and they're standing on the surface of the water, walking on water. And the bishop's all shocked, and he says, says, what's going on? They said, Bishop, we got a problem. You know, we're so used to doing the style we're used to. You know, we're so grateful you came and teach us the official style, but we forgot how to do it. Could you tell us again how to do it? And the bishop said, you just keep doing what your style, what you're doing, okay? It's working for you. God bless. And the monks said, oh, thank you, Bishop. They went running back to the island, you know. So this is a great story because you know, do it in your style, but make sure, you know, make sure you're evaporating the continuity fear. That when you are, you're wowing your success is essential. You could call it anything you want to. Maybe Talopa calls it something different, whatever. Wow your success. That's what I call it. I like calling it like this. I'm comfortable with it. Wow your success. And then clarity will arise. And you're like, wow. Tremendous clarity. I'm not used to that. It's so sublime. Thank you. Thank you, continuity fear, for allowing this. Thank myself for allowing this. And of course, continuity fear is my own problem. So I thank you, continuity, for allowing this. And so I'm going to, in honoring you for allowing this, I'm going to honor you now by wowing it instead of getting greedy. Okay? Don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. And then so then you start trusting more and more. You start trusting yourself. You're not going to get too greedy. You're not going to overwhelm yourself. You're not going to overload yourself. You're not going to leap into total empowerment. You're going to allow some continuity fear to remain. You're going to keep playing with this. You become more and more sublime. You trust yourself. You trust yourself. You trust yourself. More and more and more. That's how it works. You can call it any labels you want, any style you want, but that's the heart of it. You trust yourself more and more in evaporating this continuity fear. So we have great news coming. Forget it. Who cares about the election? Ananda Maima is going to show up. She most certainly will. And who else? Who knows? Longchampa may show up. They may all show up in one way or the other. To counter it. That this is their response to it. This is their response. They will respond. They will respond. They will respond to 45. And they will protect the yogins of this world. They most certainly will. Anyone who thinks otherwise has a mental illness, actually. So keep trusting in your path. That's the yogin that trusts in their path. Trust themselves. That's developed enough trust in themselves that they can keep wowing, committed to wowing their success, and the success keeps arising and more sublime. That's a true yogin. That's a true yogin. Okay. You will be protected. Whatever your style may be, whatever your style may be quite different, but the heart of it's the same, isn't it? You get used more and more sublime, used to it, more and more gentle glory, more and more gentle glory, getting used to it, used to it. I've had so much in my life, and it's about to get way better. Absolutely, it is. I got my golf swing ready. You know, for at least the driver. If you hit the driver, crush the driver, everything else is frosting on the cake. Yeah, it's like, oh, I missed that putt. Well, that's okay. I'll get another chance the next hole. At least you give yourself a chance. Yeah, crush the driver, you give yourself a chance. Why are these pros so relaxed? Because they crush the driver. They say, I didn't birdie that hole. Well, I'll have a good chance the next hole. No problem. Of course they're relaxed. That's their secret. That's being a pro. A pro is crushing your driver. They all crush their drivers. Come on. They all drive the ball great. Every single one of them. You can't crush the driver. You can't be a pro. It's not possible. So knowing to wow your success, that makes you a pro. I mean, you're on the pro track. You do it really well. You know, you're a pro. You're a yogin. You're a pro. You know how to manage your success. You're a pro. You don't, you're a hacker. Again, either repent, either choose repentance, either choose mental illness, or you choose to work on evaporating your continuity fear. And repentance means you choose to evaporate your continuity fear. That's what it means. You just choose to evaporate that, and that's the only choice we have here. It's the only choice we really have here. That's it. This is just about finished here. Yeah. So just wow this video. A lot of great information here. Don't worry about 45. You know, 45 will come out blazing. You know, the Clintons will come out. But don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. We got something that to really trump that. Genuine trumping. Not this other Trump, but a genuine trumping of that. I think this Trump helped get us ready to realize that we can trump it. Okay, we don't need to be slaves. Infantile slaves. But the real trumping is going to happen for us, for the yogins, for the fortunate yogins who prepared for this time. I prepared for it. I was alerted to it, and I got down to business and prepared for it. That's what a yogin does. Hallelujah. So be ready to celebrate. Be in a celebratory mode, not in a freak out mode. Okay, stay in celebration. I'll have some videos for you. If you like the Sublime stuff, just let me know. Say, hey, I love this. I love it. There's no story. There's hardly any storyline. There's just Juan Carlos, Cali Ross looking for Juan Carlos, and Smoothie Ross comes in, and Uncle Ross comes in, but it's just looking for Juan Carlos and search for Juan Carlos. I'm looking for Juan Carlos today.